Thank you. Schubert im Kopf.
Thank you.
ピアニストマレー・ペライア、ベルリン・フィルやウィーン・フィルなど世界の一流オーケストラと共演を重ねている、今最も注目されているピアニストです。ペライアさんは今年4月、1991年以来7年ぶりに来日しました。
今回は3度目ですか、7年ぶりの来日となりますけれども、この7年間というのはどういうふうに音楽と関わってらしたでしょう。
Oh dear. Well, I should say that for some of that time, aboutIn the end, 4 years of that time, I wasn't playing, because I had an injury to my finger, and because of that injury, it was, at first it was something minor, it was like an infection, but it never really got right, and because there were some mistakes and things that happened that weren't quite right, it ended up being about 4 years that I didn't play.And that's part of the reason why I stopped touring and doing concerts like I regularly did, and why I couldn't come here as well.
ピアニストにとって命ともいえる指を怪我してしまったペライアさん。周囲からは復帰を心配する声も上がっていました。しかし96年、ペライアさんはファン待望の復帰を果たします。
じゃあその再びピアノに向かって自分の音楽が自分で弾ける、その喜びを感じた時ってどんな感じだったんでしょう。
Yeah, it was wonderful to be able to play again. And, you know, because it was a serious operation, what I had, it was on the bone, that they removed something on the bone. Coming back was very slow. It took a long time. At first, I thought I wasn't going to be able to make it. And it was, I think the operation was in September. I was slowly beginning to play by the end of December. February was my first concert.In fact, it was with Celibidache in Munich, and it was a Mozart concerto, and it was thrilling to be able to play again. Only, as I said, since it was a slow recovery, I still wasn't sure whether I could play really heavy things with chords, and that was only until April or May, that I started playing more heavier programs, things like Schumann,things like the Emperor Concerto. And so it was a very slow discovery and a very slow return to the piano, but every moment was for me a thrill.
ペライアさんはこれまでに1976年と1991年の2度来日しています。久々に行われた今回の演奏会には、来日を待ち望んだファンが大勢集まりました。
ペライアさんは子供時代どういうふうに音楽と関わってきたのか、最初どういうふうに音楽と出会ったのか話していただけますか。
I had a very early encounter with music. Really, the first time was I was about 3 and a half, and I went to the opera with my father. My mother didn't like so much classical music. She still doesn't now, to this day. But my father loved the opera. I think he wanted to be a musician, and so he would take me. And when I would come home, I would start singing the things that I heard at the opera. And so he decided maybe we should get a piano. We got a little toy piano at the beginning, and also a neighborhood teacher. And she insisted on a big piano. And so pretty soon, when I was 4, I was playing the big piano. But I didn't like to practice very much. What I liked to do was to play. And I would play most of the day improvising. And I could make up things based on a lot on the operas that I went to hear. So I would play very much Italian music, Italian operas, singing, playing, composing. I did a lot of composing. And eventually I started to get more serious and started not only reading music, but playing, you know, sonatas and Bach and Mozart, things like this. Still, a lot of my adventures in music were the things that I shouldn't have been doing, like transcriptions I liked playing and Spanish music I liked playing. I did a lot of things I shouldn't have done.
小さい時にそのピアノのレッスンを受けられたっていうことですけれども、それはどんな先生で、どの辺で、どういうふうな形で受けられたんでしょう?
Actually, when I was 6, I had one principal teacher, Jeanette Hain. And she was rather young. She was 22. I was her first student. And in a way, I was her project. So she started me not only at the piano, but with ear training and with theory and with all aspects, composition, all aspects of music making that were, you know, to make a complete musician, not just a pianist. And I studied with her almost exclusively until I was 17. She was my only teacher, Jeanette Hain. And then at 17, I went to Marlborough. I actually went to a music camp before that, but Marlborough was my first really big experience. And there I met Casals, and he was a very great influence on me, a very important influence. He liked me very much, and he invited me to his home in Puerto Rico. And I stayed there for about a week at a time for something like 2 or 3 years. And we made a lot of music together. And I must say, the influence that I felt for him as a musician, I think was very strong. And I also met Rudolf Serkin there, and Mieczysław Horshavsky, who I later studied with when I was 19. And many years later, through Mr. Serkin, who was a very close friend of his, I was able to meet Vladimir Horowitz. In fact, Horowitz wanted me to study with him when I was 19, but I felt maybe he was too strong, and I felt that I wouldn't be able to survive. I didn't know how I would take it, so I didn't study with Mr. Horowitz at that time. Many, many years later, towards the end of his life, I got to know him very well. And we spent a lot of time together. I think I was very lucky, actually, in many ways, because also my parents, while they encouraged me to make music, they didn't push me. In fact, they didn't order me to practice, which I think was very good. At least I felt it was useful, because I could improvise, I could play on my own, I could compose, I could do all kinds of things. In fact, my grandmother, who lived in the house with us, she was very old. She died at the age of 97. She would stay inside and make sure I was working or whatever. And I could easily fool her. I used to play records and would go out and play ball and then come back and say, Grandma, did I practice well? She said, okay. And that was that. I never practiced.
ペライアさんは1947年、ニューヨークのブロンクスで生まれました。一つ年下の弟とともに、 のびのびした子供時代を送ったといいます。
じゃあもう少しそのおばあちゃん以外にそのご家族のことで何かエピソードってございますか？
I can't remember everything. I do remember a time when Mr. Serkin, he said that he wanted me to study with his friend, Mr. Horowitz. I was still living, of course, at home with my parents. And he said that somebody from Sony, well, I guess it was CBS at that time, would be in touch with me about that. And would call me. I didn't hear for quite a while. I think in November, some point, some man in a very deep voice called at my house and asked to speak to Mr. Pariah. I told him my father would come in a minute, I'd call him. He said, no, it's not your father. I want to speak to Murray Pariah. I said, yes. Who is this? He says, well, this is Mr. Horowitz. I figured it was the grocer. Mr. Horowitz, because we have a lot of Mr. Horowitzes in the neighborhood. And I was sort of annoyed, and I said, what could I do for you, Mr. Horowitz? And he says, I don't think you understand. No, I'm a friend of Mr. Serkin's. And my father, who was there at the time, he said, quick, get off the phone. I need to use the phone. And I said, no, it's Mr. Horowitz. He said, I don't care who it is. I need to use the phone. And I couldn't get him away from the phone. But anyway, I did speak to Mr. Horowitz, and this was one of the stories I remember from living at my parents' house.
ペライアさんは1972年、25歳の時にリーズ国際ピアノコンクールで優勝を果たし、一躍脚光を集めます。当時弟子を取らないと言われていた大ピアニストウラディーミル・ホロビッツも彼に注目しました。その後何年か後、ペライアさんはホロビッツをたびたび訪ねます。
Horowitz said to me, he said, if you want to be more than a virtuoso, first you should be a virtuoso, which I thought was very profound, because of course we all want to be more than a virtuoso. We want to say things with the music, but first we have to be able to play the piano well enough to do that. And so he encouraged me to study Liszt, and to study Rachmaninoff, and to study all the resources of the piano so that I could use them as fully as possible with whatever I wanted to do. And he told me that I could play anything, that I should play everything, because to specialize would be to, in a way, get stuck into something too soon. So he wanted me to do as much music as possible. And I just remember spending time with him, he would try to use the least possible words to say the most thoughts. He never spoke more than was necessary, and always said what applied. He always said the point.
ホロビッツと交流するようになったペライアさんは、それまで得意としてきたモーツァルトなどに加え、よりダイナミックな表現力を必要とする作品に取り組むようになりました。
今回のプログラムにはそのいろんな曲目が入っていますけれども、中にベートーベンがありますよね。ベートーベンの月光という曲は日本人 もとても好きなんですけれども、このベートーベンに対する思いというのをちょっと聞かせていただけますか？
Well, Beethoven was one of the greatest composers that ever lived. I think everything that Beethoven touched, he changed in a way radically. in this particular sonata that I'm playing, it's a combination of a fantasy and a sonata. He calls it quasi una fantasia, in fact. And the first movement is very slow, in a way paints a very dark picture. There's a lot of tragedy in it. The second movement is lighter. It's in the major, where the first movement is in the minor, and contrasts very completely with that very dark first movement. The last movement is very fast, in a way upset, turbulent, and very dramatic. Beethoven changed the sonata, and he made it not only a very dramatic form, but a very concise form as well. He really defined what a sonata is. And this piece is a very imaginative example of the sonata. As I got to work on it, and as I got to understand it, I saw a lot of similarities between the movements. A lot of things I can't completely show are based on this arpeggio figure. A lot of the idea for the whole piece, in fact, has this arpeggio as a sort of recurrent theme. Even the last movement is all this arpeggio. Even the main notes of the arpeggio are stressed throughout the movement. It seems to be a recurrent theme. But as I got to work on it more and more, a program developed for me about it. And I don't know that it would be anybody else's program, but the program that I see in it is Beethoven's depiction of the last scene of Romeo and Juliet, and where Juliet is in the tomb, and Romeo comes and sees her and thinks that she's dead. And it just helps me set the mood a little bit for this very dark piece. I mean, it doesn't have to be anybody else's program. The second movement for me is more Juliet waking and not knowing quite what's happening, and it's more optimistic in tone. And the last movement is more the messenger trying to come before it's too late. Of course, he comes when it is too late. But for me, it helps to have a program that suggests the music using the main ideas that are in the music.
I'm
very close to it, so it's hard for me to say. It's like saying, do you see your children grow up? You can't, you know. Suddenly they become bigger, they're different people, and you wonder, when did that happen? I just saw them yesterday, they were small. So the same with your playing. I see it every day, so I can't really tell. I do feel, though, people tell me, and something in me has changed. Quite what it is, I don't know. But perhaps it is that I feel I can go deeper. because in a way I lost everything. For a moment I lost everything. And then I found it again. And so nothing else can be as bad as that.
今回は2人の息子さんと奥さんを連れて来日しました。音楽家は世界を飛び歩いてそのコンサートを行い、家族と一緒に過ごす時間というのが本当に少ないと思いますけれども、ペラヤさんの心の支えというのはやっぱり奥様と2人のお子様でしょうか。
I would say very much my family keeps me going. In fact, when I wasn't able to play for quite a while, it seemed to me that the only bright part of that episode was that I was at home and could see my children grow up. And I spent a lot of time with them. And that meant a lot to me. Now that they're in school, the older one is 14, the younger one is 10, it's difficult to take them all the time with us. We're lucky that they came here. They have school break now. We like to take them as often as possible with them because they're a great joy, and my family gives me a lot of joy.
2人の息子さんは音楽家に将来したいとお考えですか?
Oh no, not at all. No, they've exhibited no interest in it really. In fact, they only like rock music. It's pretty depressing for me. The eldest is quite interested in computers, and the youngest, his whole life is football. So I don't know what they'll become, but it certainly won't be in music.
毎日毎日そのツアーでお忙しくて練習もお忙しくて他のことをする時間でなかなかないと思いますけれども、音楽を離れた時間って何をしてらっしゃるでしょう。
You're right. Music does take a lot of my time, and not only my time, my thoughts. I'm constantly thinking about it and involved in it, and it's a very important part of my life, music, and trying to understand it, really. What we always do, though, at home is from, let's say, 6 o'clock till 8 o'clock, we devote that to the children, and we spend time with them, we have dinner with them, we're generally with them. For those 2 hours, I'm always with them. But for the rest of the time, I'll either be listening to music, practicing, or spending a lot of time thinking about it.
先ほどのお話の中に、その長い間のブランクを越えたという話がありますけれども、その壁にぶつかった時は何が一番救いとなるでしょう?
I'm not good at giving advice. I can only barely live my own life without telling anybody what to do. Recently, I got an offer. Somebody was asking advice for the 20th century. I have no idea about advice. All I can say for me, what sustained me in that period were two things. One, the very strong love I have for music, and so I very much was in music even though I couldn't play. It didn't bother me that I couldn't play. I mean, of course it bothered me, but it didn't take me away from music. And the other was that I was rooted in my family, my wife and my kids, and so that I was around them. Those two things helped me enormously.
この日本公演の後もアジアやヨーロッパ、アメリカなど 世界各地での演奏会がすでに 2000年まで予定されています。
日本はとてもピアノを習っている人の人口が多い国なんですけれども、若い人に向けて何かそのペラヤさんがアドバイスできること、そしてこれからの教育に関して何かお考えになっていることを教えていただけますか?
Yes. You know, the most important thing, even more important than playing the piano, is loving music. Because the love of music, believe it or not, can be destroyed, even perhaps by practicing too much. Practicing again and again the same passage, or again and again the same piece. And then you can't stand the piece anymore. You hate the music and you don't want to. And this is, I find, one of the great dangers, to lose the love of music. And I really think that one has to keep this alive, has to keep the love of music alive. And how does one keep it alive? I think by listening. It's important to listen to a lot of music. If you're studying, for instance, Beethoven, to study the string quartets, the symphonies, not just the piano music. Not for a pianist to stay only in the piano is very limiting, and it's not good for a musician. That's one. And the other, which I feel is very important, is to study the laws of music, to study counterpoint, to study harmony, and to see always what a composer is doing. And you see, we can love Beethoven, we can love Mozart, we can love Bach, but music is greater than one man, is greater than any individual man. It's something, it's an art that is so beautiful, that demands so much from one in terms of emotions and love and things, that one has to study it. One has to study it away from the individual, away from Beethoven, away from Mozart, away from Schubert, just to study music. And this might seem boring, but it's not at all boring, because it's only through studying music that one can learn what it's about and one can gain a deeper love for it. So all my advice would be to keep this love of music alive.
現在は情報が氾濫して非常に混乱した社会ですけれども、そうした中でのクラシック音楽が人々に果たす役割というものをどういうふうにお考えでしょうか。
I feel, and this might be a rather old-fashioned feeling, but I feel that the great works of the classical music will never die. That's the great works of Bach and Mozart and Beethoven and Schubert and so many will never die becauseThey've reached such a height of perfection in every way. Perfection in terms of musical understanding, perfection in terms of articulating the needs of the human spirit. I think that these things will always, much like the great works of literature, like Shakespeare, like Goethe, they will always be an inspiration for humanity as long as there is humanity that can feel.And so I think that classical music will never, ever be effaced. I worry that we might not have the education to understand it, but I think that, as is happening here and is happening elsewhere, that people are taking it seriously, that classical music will continue to inspire people as it has for many, many years, because they reach such a height ofunderstanding, a height of achievement, really, that I feel that it, as I said, will never die.
ピアニスト、マレー・ペライア。これからも音楽の道を歩み続けます。